There we go. Clap if you want to. Like a star in the night, where there's darkness, shine your light. Hand in hand, take a stand for our time. Build the bridge, let it dream, that it's easier than it seems. Hand in hand, take a stand for our time. For our time, for our time, for our time, for our time. Hand in hand, take a stand for our time. Oh brother, I have done you wrong when I refuse to listen to your song. Sister, I have poured you many tears. My brother, I have fallen down. My sister, when you come around, I will build my life on love, not fear. For our time, for our time, for our time, for our time. And then take a stand for our time. For our time, for our time, for our time, for our time. And then take a stand for our time. Thank you. Thank you.
Bon Dora. Alex Bon Dora. You guys may remember him as a member of A Moment's Worth. They were here back in 2011. They were the winners of our special prize from Campus Music Fest that year. So welcome back. We're going to hear a little more from him as he embarks on a solo debut, and we'll hear his new stuff in a little bit. Stuff that we have to do, get things out of the way, but usually all these things are very typed up, but Ted tells me that I can kind of wing it today, and Marion says it's okay because Ted said it was okay. So, normally this is the time I tell you guys you have to turn off your phones, turn off your beepers, for those of you guys old enough to know what a beeper is. But today, all we need you to do is silence them. In addition to that, what we would like you to do is tweet this evening, all throughout the evening as you see different events, tweet away, and we've given you guys a couple of different hashtags. It's in your favorite box, so as you tweet, use the hashtags, and that should be helpful for everyone. So again, on behalf of the Elfenworks Foundation family, we want to welcome all of you here tonight. It's wonderful to have all of you, to share an evening with you, an hour of time to be uplifted by some of the most remarkable people in our country doing some amazing things to inspire hope within our country. My name is Ken Tam, and I am the one who's going to help kick off this evening. This evening, we're going to meet three more special social entrepreneurs, and I think you're going to really like what their message and what they're doing. In addition, Before that, we want to let everybody know that every year that, as we've been doing this, the city of Burlingame is really getting into it as well. And today, October the 1st, 2015, has been declared the In Harmony with Hope Day. So thank you very much, city of Burlingame. We're going to also hear from a couple of our partners. That's Pillar 4 for all of you who've read the book. We're going to hear from the two Davids, David Grusky and David Romer, from Stanford's Center for Poverty and Inequality and Campus Movie Fest. We're also, of course, going to hear from our founder and CEO, Lauren Spieth. She'll tell you about what's happening with the foundation. And more importantly, and one of the things that we're really excited about this year is a new initiative where we will be working with and helping nonprofits. And we're going to hear about that initiative and project from Don Kane. I want to let everybody know, I think everybody who's looked on stage tonight is introduce you to our special guest this evening. It is our famous actor from Hollywood, Elijah Kelly, who hails from LaGrange, Georgia. I think some of you have seen him in some of his many projects. I think all of you know Hairspray, Red Tails, and of course my wife's favorite, The Butler. In addition to his acting, what he's also doing is helping others realize the acting dream. So he has a foundation where he helps youth follow in his footsteps, the youth from his hometown in LaGrange, go and follow their dreams into acting. So that's one of the things that he does as well. On December the 3rd, you will see him as the lovable scarecrow in the upcoming show, The Wiz. So at this point, I'd like to introduce Brad Lambert, who is one of our big supporters here at the Elfenworks. He is with us today again from Wells Fargo Bank's Wealth Management Division.
I keep expecting Ken to say, but first a word from our sponsors, but he never actually does that. So I had an opportunity to meet, I had an opportunity to meet the honorees last night, at least two of the three, and spend some time with the Elfenworks family. And I said to a couple people that these are two of my favorite nights in the whole year. So we really appreciate being here, appreciate being associated and supporting Elfenworks. On behalf of Wells Fargo, I thank you all for being here. And we're just honored, really, to be part of this. And personally, I'm just happy to be back. So thank you very much.
From the Stanford Center on Poverty and Equality, please help me welcome the director, David Grusky.
Hello, everyone. It's really great to be here. You know, it was nearly 10 years ago when the Elfenworks Foundation itself, a startup, reached out to help the Stanford Center on Poverty and Inequality, and in effect, they converted us from a startup ourselves to one of the three national poverty centers in the country. And the genius, and I've been. The genius of Elfenworks, the real genius of Elfenworks, I think, is that they recognize that there are decisive moments in the histories and the lives of organizations. They help when help really matters, and by virtue of doing that, they transform in quite amazing ways. They did it with us. They've done it with many other organizations in the past, and they're continuing to do it tonight. By way of demonstrating that point, I'd like now to turn the stage over to Don Kane, the Chief Information Security Officer of Elfenworks, and he's going to announce a program, an Elfenworks program, that helps nonprofits improve their IT security. So welcome, Don.
Thank you. It's wonderful to see you all here tonight. I'd like to talk to you tonight about changing another story, the cybersecurity story. We want nonprofits to be robust and resilient despite the cyber risk and the incentive to spend every last dollar on programs. But we want them to have it all, to know the right questions to ask their experts. To help this happen, we're building a website that will encourage, inspire, and educate. It's called the Elfenworks Center for Nonprofit Information Security Collaboration. That's a mouthful. We call it Echinacea. It's online at www.ecnisc.org. We've been hard at work for 2 years now. We've got the basics posted, and our self-assessment tool is getting its final touches. We're looking for a few early adopters, those who enjoy that bleeding-edge experience and want to try it out. If that's you, ping us on our contact page, or come ask me for a card later, and stay in touch.
Thank you.
When you inspire action, you're the key to hope. See this key? It says hope. But I know the real key to hope. It's the storytellers at Campus Movie Fest.
The new generation is the ones that can improve and can lead on something better than the one before and make a change.
Such an honor to be in a room with such fresh dreamers. You guys are pretty much the most amazing part of my week.
You are storytellers, and you can never underestimate your ripple as you move forward in your life.
Please help me welcome to the stage David Romer, founder and CEO of Campus Movie Fest.
Thanks very much. It's an honor to be here and one of my favorite nights. I just want to ask you to picture a million college students, giving them laptops, cameras, training, and telling them to go make something. I feel like because you're a good crowd, you'll probably take that in a positive direction. I might not have asked some other crowds to picture that. But that's what we've gotten to do over the last 15 years, is we've grown Campus Movie Fest into the world's largest student film festival. Over a million students have made short films, and we've seen everything. Comedies, dramas, westerns, genres that you can't even define. But also over the years, we've been getting more and more of these inspiring short films that are all about social justice issues. Powerful, all about hope, and I think it's for two reasons. The first is good news. The next generation really does want to help solve these issues. They do want to make a difference in the world. But they need some help, and that's the second reason. And that's Lauren and the team at Elfenworks that empowers them and inspires them and supports us in this opportunity. So it's just been an amazing partnership, and we want to thank you very much for that. I figured instead of talking more about it, I would ask some of our winners for a couple of thoughts that I could share with them and share with you. Again, a cynical audience would say that, so I didn't have to prepare more. But you're a good audience, so you wouldn't think that. One of our winners, Jade Zhao, who won the U.S. Grand Prize, said that getting up to that stage to accept the award still feels surreal till today. It's helped me realize my dream of filmmaking. It was a team of students from China, so with the language barrier, it meant even more. And she's always believed that there's no great film without a message, and winning the Elfenworks Award definitely inspired her to make more films with social justice messages. She believes that together we can make a difference. Kevin and Calvin Ross, the second place in the U.S., identical twin team, said, "Have you ever heard the stories about how people made their first dollar? Well, this is our first check," and I probably should have put it up there instead of on my phone. Can everybody see that? Thanks to the Elfenworks Foundation for blessing us with such an amazing reward. This will definitely help us become grounded in our future endeavors to make the world a better place. And then lastly, from one of our UK winners, Christopher Hanby, he was surprised but very pleased to win this prize. But the most important part was that his friend Jay, who is the star of the film, is still currently homeless. They had agreed they would split the prize money, so now Jay was able to get off the streets He's going to continue making films about him to keep telling these positive stories. So we could keep going with a lot more. My battery's about to die, so I'm not going to share more here. Elfenworks probably can't fix that, but fortunately, Elfenworks is fixing a whole lot more out there, and we're just so proud to be a partner as part of this. So thanks very much for having us here tonight. Along with searching for the best movie makers, we've also had the privilege of searching for the best musicians. And Ken did a great job introducing Alex, and now I just get to welcome him back up on stage here.
Thank you for that. That was wonderful. Far away to know what's in your heart. You look far away to know your home. Always on the go, a man and his guitar. Your bags are never unpacked, and you haven't settled. You never settled. You're always running, always running, you're always running. Oh, you're always running, always running, you're always running. Oh, your sister calls you, says you should see a mom. Didn't feel so good today. When your brother's gone, he has a girlfriend now. Your dad still calls you every day. Yeah, you're always running, always running. You're always running, no. Always running, always running, you're always running, no. You know I miss you, but you'll always miss yourself more. I never sit still. You never sleep well no more. You know I miss you, but you know I'll always miss yourself more. I never sit still. You never sleep well. Thank you.
Alex Bondaroff, everyone. Thank you very much, Alex. We're going to take a little bit of time while we get the stage ready. In the meantime, I think some of the hashtags that we were talking about, in case you guys didn't open your favors, inspire, mentoring, peace, hopeless, anti-bullying, entrepreneur. Anybody know how to spell that? Change, and of course, in harmony with hope. Without further ado, the CEO and founder of the Elfenworks, Dr. Lauren Spieth.
Thank you. and they lived happily ever after. Think about some of your favorite endings. They surprise, they stun, they delight. You didn't see them coming. They turn everything you thought you knew and understood upside down. You think, how did they do that? It's simple. Write the ending first, and the rest of the narrative falls into place. Think through the steps it takes to get there. Take one step, and then take another, and another. But simple isn't easy. It's work to envision a compelling ending. That's why Jimmy Carter's advice to me started with vision. Stick to your vision, don't listen to the naysayers. It can change your storyline to dare to dream, to dare to hope, to dare to take action. Happy birthday, President Carter. Happy birthday. He's 91. No, simple isn't easy. That choice to live with engaged optimism, it's made every morning. But it's within reach of all of us. It starts with a kind word, a helping hand, a desire to make our ripple a positive one. There are a lot of scary scenarios out there where bleak endings are outlined, heralded as inevitabilities, and dare we say, celebrated. A lot of reasons to give up hope. It takes a fierce determination to move forward day in and day out in the face of such forces. You know, it is wonderful to see old friends and new for this hope-filled event tonight. You've just heard Alex from our partner band A Moment's Worth sing Always Running from his solo effort Conversing with Oceans, and earlier our peace song For Our Time, which he's taken in a powerful direction, and I loved it. I know you did. And you've heard some of our very important partners, David Romer of Campus Movie Fest, David Grusky of Stanford, and Brad Lambert of Wells Fargo Bank, which our partner, thank you so much. And I have to give a shout out to our returning honorees here tonight. I think Joyce Dattner's here. I haven't had a chance to see her, but I think she's here, and Margaret Martin, and Paul Minerini, and Gary Oppenheimer, and I think Brenda Ehart might be here tonight. Oh, awesome! And soon I'll be handing over the stage to our distinguished MC, Elijah Kelly, a young actor with a big impact in television and film storylines, who joined our story at Campus Movie Fest, presenting our CMF Social Justice Award to some brilliant storytellers. The winning film featured a blue butterfly and told a tale that broke with our expectations, while the runner-up started off starkly, "I am a terrible thing," and then defies that conclusion, echoing the old, "a mind is a terrible thing to waste." And those are just two. It's so reassuring to see how the future is in such good hands. Traditionally, I take some time to tell you what we've been up to, like our free butterfly app and our echinacea project and our peace project, but tonight we've changed that story, and I've left that job to others, so that I can focus on one simple idea. A new message of hope about how you can change the story. Did you see that sign up front that said fairy tales are real because they teach us that dragons can be tamed? Did you see that? We changed that last word to tamed. It was beaten. With one little syllable, we forged a totally different story. One word, because we all have dragons. And even so, we have agency. We can participate in weaving our own story, our own narrative, and we all have the power of the storyteller. In big and small ways, each of us can tackle those scary elements, dragons of dissonance and despair, bringing them in harmony with hope. for ourselves and for the greater good, like these three dragon tamers that you'll meet this evening. Each of us can change the story. This is the key to why we're here tonight, and why we've done this year after year, to remind ourselves, we band of brothers, that we can, we must, we will be effective agents of lasting and positive change. And so we turn this evening's story on its head as we not only honor the change makers in the spotlight, we honor you as well. In reality, this is your night. Let the stories of change you hear tonight inspire you with new possibilities for your stories. Let them warm you from your heart to your toes. And let the night fill you up and restore you for the work ahead. Your story, let it begin anew tonight. Once upon a time. Take it away, Elijah Kelly.
That was so eloquent. I do want to point out that you did give somebody a shout out, though. So somebody was listening to some Tupac today. We are in Marin County. I'm so overwhelmed right now. Honestly, I can't look at these cards. I'm supposed to do some opening remarks where I think Lauren, you know, where we met on Campus Movie Fest, but I come from a place where the kids that you help exist. I come from a place where they're my cousins, they're my brothers, they're my families, they're my sisters, they're my friends, and I've seen the kind of hearts that you guys have and the kinds of hearts that help those types of children. And I'm so elated to be in the same room with each and every one of you. And I so thank you for inviting me to this. I wouldn't have missed it for the world. With that being said, we're about to meet three remarkable people: Eric Dawson, Ted Gonder, and Rose Broom. They each proved that there's no need to wait to rewrite your life story. They all discovered their passion when they were very young and began directly changing lives and the lives of people around them all their life. So, let's learn a little bit more about them. Gotta bring the lights back up. I'm delighted to present our first recipient of the evening from Boston. Go Red Sox. Or not. Celtics, baked beans. The co-founder of Peace First, Eric Dawson. The first chapter of Eric's story was written during his childhood. Catalyzed by an episode of violence and his parents' work with high-risk youth, Eric started an anti-bullying organization in high school that changed students' attitudes. In college, he became involved in the annual Boston Festival called the Peace Games, and by that time he graduated, he had transformed the annual festival into a year-long conflict resolution program and integrated Peace Games as a nonprofit. More than 20 years later, Peace Games is now called Peace First, and it's a national movement whose aim is to spark conversation about our potential of the young people and their ability to create positive and meaningful change. They achieve their goals through two distinct programs: teaching peace-building skills to young children through a specially designed curriculum, and recognizing that each leadership program called the Peace First Prize. The Digital Activity Center's curriculum, developed in cooperation with Harvard's Education School, provides lesson plans for developmentally appropriate experimental activities and cooperative games to address things like conflict resolution, fairness, and consequences of actions. Community service learning projects give the kids the chance to put their newly acquired skills into action. Thousands of educators from every state in the union use free online tools to bring Peace First curriculum into their schools, helping to build the culture of caring across the country and changing the narrative of violence so our many young people do not get exposed to that anymore. The other initiative, the Peace First Prize, it was designated to recognize young people who have a courage and compassion, people who have the courage and compassion to create lasting change. A $25,000 reward accompanies the prize, and a two-year fellowship program promotes leaders whose stories change, inspire, further, and spread the message of peace. A star-studded mix of spokesmen, led by former Peace First volunteer America Ferrar, whom you'll see in the video shortly, and an impressive group of partners also help their broadcast positive message. Peace First is writing a new chapter for 160,000 children who miss school every day because they are terrified of getting picked on. That's a staggering number. Peace First is writing a new chapter for the 160,000 children who miss school every day because they are terrified of getting picked on, bullied, or beaten up. That alone deserves an applause. I had a great conversation with him back there, so you know I'm not stumbling over my words. I'm just a little bit choked up because I got a chance to look into his heart with my own eyes and with my heart, and I know that it's pure. And thanks, thank you so much, man. Let's take a look at Eric's video.
Jones, and I am a peacemaker.
My name is Samir Savera, and I am a peacemaker.
I am Deborah Messing, and I am a peacemaker.
I'm America Ferreira, and I'm a peacemaker.
My name is Ian Harding.
The best thing about Peace First is that we believe passionately in the ability of young people to change the world. We have a culture of violence, which is destroying our world, and we need to create a cultural counterweight of peace, justice, and that is going to be led and created by young people.
For almost 20 years, Peace First has been teaching cooperation, communication, and peaceful conflict resolution in schools across the country. I know because in college, I taught Peace First as a volunteer.
I thought you were ugly. What's her face?
I was that too. Now I'm helping Peace First search the country for bright young people who've done something to make a real difference in their world. Like the teenager who brought together rival gangs in her community for a lasting peace treaty.
I started We Stop Hate when I was 16 years old because I had been bullied in elementary school. I kept seeing young people and my fellow classmates going through similar things to what I had gone through. I said, I can't stand this any longer. Like, I have to do something.
I am a peacemaker because I want to stand up and stop bullying.
Compassion.
I was aware that there are hungry people in my community, so I asked my mom if she could help me help people by giving them food. We have raised over 300,000 pounds of food. We have raised over $150,000, and we have helped over 7,200 families. My big goal would be to stomp out world hunger.
When I was 12, I performed a hip-hop dance for a room full of teenagers with disabilities. I invited audience members to come on stage and dance with me. Seeing their joy from performing in front of their peers showed me how dance can be used as a powerful tool for building self-esteem and bringing people together.
Collaborative change.
Hi, my name is Simone Bernstein. The frustration with my own search for volunteer opportunities inspired me to create VolunteamNation.org. Youth volunteers gain skills and are empowered to take action and create and implement positive changes throughout the world.
It doesn't matter what your passion in life is, as long as you just go for it and you don't let anybody stand in your way.
Last year, we transformed a total of 1 acre of urban land into productive ecosystems.
My goal has been to teach young people and police how to communicate better.
We also work to change the culture of schools so that schools are places where students learn these skills are celebrated and valued. We've been able to reduce the levels of violence at our schools between 60 and 100%, so there's less guns, knives, gangs, defacement of property, racial slurs. And just as important, we've been able to increase the pro-social efficacy of students. So our students are significantly and statistically more likely to resolve conflicts without fighting and to stand up for someone who's being picked on.
And so this has been the work of Peace First, to inspire young people to lead, to encourage teachers to teach peacemaking as a core part of what they do. All of our curriculum's online, so if you're a school teacher or a parent and you want to learn how do I teach my kids how to be peacemakers, all those materials are online for you to use, and so we hope that you will join us.
One person can make a difference, but it's easier with more than one.
Courage.
Compassion.
Collaborative change.
Be a peacemaker.
Go ahead.
Try it on.
Come on, E-Money. He's a rapper too.
Hello. Good evening. It's a slow crowd. I have a 7-year-old son, and I was tucking him in via phone, kind of a crappy dad tonight. And he was asking me where I was going tonight. And I said, I'm going to a fancy party. And he thought about it for a moment. He goes, how fancy? I said, I don't know. Well, there'll be like wine and white tablecloths. I said, maybe. How about a disco ball? And people saying bonjour when you come in. I said, I don't know. It's San Francisco. Then he thought for a moment, he goes, how about pin the tail on the donkey? Thank you for throwing a fancy party. And for bonjour. C'est bon. That's the only French I know. Thank you for this honor. Thank you for having me. It's been great to meet such wonderful human beings who care deeply about the world. And it's an honor to be here. I want to start with a quick story, and it's a parable that some of you may have heard about, a grandfather and his grandson. And the grandfather's upset, and the grandson approaches him and says, grandfather, what's wrong? And the grandfather turns to his grandson and says, my son, I feel like I have these two wolves, and they're fighting inside of me. One wolf is angry and vengeful and violent, and the other wolf is loving and peaceful and kind. And they're at war inside my spirit. The grandson thinks about this for a moment and then turns to his grandfather and says, well, grandfather, which of these two wolves is going to win this battle? To which the grandfather replies, my son, whichever wolf I choose to feed. Brothers, sisters, we do a tremendous job of feeding this wolf of violence among our young people. We sit here on the eve of another horrific mass shooting at a school. More lives lost, more blood shed. 160,000 kids were not in school today because they were scared to go to school. One out of four high school students reports being bullied every month in the United States. By the time children finish sixth grade, my oldest daughter's age, they've seen 100,000 acts of violence on television. We feed this wolf. Not only do we feed this wolf of violence for our young people, we tend to think of young people as victims, right, that we need to protect, that we need to keep safe, or perpetrators that we need to lock up, or even worse, and we've all been guilty of this, we describe young people as the future, right? How many of you have had those words come out of your mouth at some point, right? You're gonna be a great artist someday. You're gonna be a great leader someday. You're gonna be a great actor someday, which has the way of saying, well, you're none of those things right now. Young people are not the future. They are the present. Thank you. I want to talk about this other wolf, which is this wolf of peace. This wolf that young people across the country are feeding every day. The wolf that was fed by a 10-year-old girl in New York City. First thing she does when she walks into the lunchroom every day is she scans the lunchroom. She finds that one kid that no one is sitting with, and she goes and sits with that kid every day. Bella, who you saw on the video, 9 years old, witnessed a special needs student at her school being bullied. And she realized that in her school, 5% of the kids are picking on 10% of the kids, and the other 85% are doing what? Standing around watching. So this 9-year-old girl, small school, rural Colorado, started a campaign called Be a Buddy, Not a Bully. Well, she got every single student in her school to commit to sign a pledge to being a buddy and not a bully. Wee Chen, another young person, badly bullied school. There's one day at a school where 26 students, all Asian immigrant students, were assaulted at a school, 13 of whom had to go to the hospital. This young man led an 8-day boycott of his high school. 8-day boycott, said, we're not going to participate in a system that doesn't see us as human. Filed a Justice Department lawsuit, which they won, that said, we actually have a right to be safe in our school. These young people are not unicorns. They exist. And I would be so bold as to say they may exist in our homes and in our faith communities and maybe in this room. Our job is to feed the wolf of peace, of kindness, and love in our young people. So I challenge you to do that. I challenge you, for those of you who have young people in your lives, to ask them every day, how are you a peacemaker? We need to reclaim that word and make it powerful and muscular. And we need to use the pronoun we. There's no such thing as those kids or those communities. They are ours. Thank you.
Amazing. Thank you again for all the work you do. It's truly an amazing video, amazing message, amazing movement. How many people were touched by that? Yeah. I was too. You know, guys, I'm always really cool, but my heart is like bursting out of my chest right now. Like, it is some real, like, genuine love and change. I was sitting over here talking, and I was like, you believe wholeheartedly in every word that you speak. I just asked her this, and I looked back into her eyes, and I said, I do too. And with that, with her, with all of you in this room, I don't think why this change can't be just disastrously effective. You know, and I'm ready for it. I'm ready for it, man. You guys are amazing. Our next recipient is from Chicago. Go Bulls. Michael Jordan Bulls. My man Ted Gonder from Money Think. Ted's purpose wasn't always clear. He describes himself as an aimless teen, occasionally depressed, and a mediocre student. That was me this afternoon. A 19-year-old Ghanaian tutor who had saved all of his money for a plane ticket to come to the US and pursue an American dream helped change Ted's story. This mentor changed Ted's worldview by teaching him to treat his decisions as investments for his future. The future was much on Ted's mind as he and fellow students of the University of Chicago's Blue Chip Investment Club were researching the data on financial literacy and the onset of the most recent recession. The data revealed that 1/3 of adults don't pay their bills on time, and that strikingly 1/2 have no personal safety net. 18 to 24-year-olds were the ones that are filing for bankruptcy right now. That's the fastest growing demographic. Examining these numbers in the context of our country's growing inequality made these students think, What if college students served as mentors teaching financial literacy investment skills to low-income high school students? Within a year, the then full-time students had branded their concept into an organization called Money Think. Drawing partly on Ted's own transformative experience with the mentor, they developed a mentor-driven curriculum. The first year, they launched a program on 10 campuses across the country. Ted saw the group's potential to be more than a college club, and under his leadership, the group filed for their nonprofit status. Today, Money Think's more than 600 volunteer mentors from 30 different colleges, reaching 2,200 students across the United States a week with powerful, relatable programming on financial planning. That's amazing, man. Taking advantage of the similarities in age between the students and their mentors, the exciting lesson content is culturally relevant and engaging. In the past year, the successful model has been further enhanced by introduction of the Money Think mobile app. Well, we're in Silicon Valley, so you might want to get that popping. It's an Instagram-like app that puts you in a financial learning family of these students where they need it the most. Young, ready, outside of the classroom, driving all the Money Think programming to the cornerstone of goals and knowledge and gain and attitude and change. The app drives the behavior change goal as it allows the real-time feedback at the moment that financial decisions are being made. People know where their money's at. 25% of high school graduates admit that they are unprepared to navigate the financial decisions of adulthood. Let's watch to see more about how Ted and Money Think are building a compelling new narrative that changes the dynamic of our children's future and finances.
A few years ago, my friends and I were studying economics at the University of Chicago, and the economy collapsed. The idea was to create a tutoring program, but instead of focusing on academics, we would focus on money.
Our generation faces some serious challenges. The income gap in the United States, it continues to widen. How do we fix something like that?
So the number one reason that students from low-income neighborhoods who get into college drop out of college is a lack of financial skills. To date, MoneyThink has trained over 1,000 college leaders to be financial mentors and positive role models to over 9,000 inner city high school students.
These students have not only demonstrated all of the characteristics that it takes to succeed in life, grit, persistence, resilience, determination, creativity, but it's also that they're just about to enter, they're on the cusp of entering the densest concentration of life-changing financial decisions they've ever had to face. College financing, the difference between a debit card and a credit card.
My name is Shane Evans, and I'm the Chief Executive Officer of the University of Chicago Charter School. Money Think matters because it connects students from top colleges and universities with young people in high schools from at-risk communities across America. It's a great program that leverages expertise and knowledge to develop financial literacy.
You should be leading. You shouldn't just be buying those phones. You should be making them. You shouldn't just be purchasing the apps. You should be designing them, right? Because the people who design those that make lots of money off of that $1.99 don't often look like us.
MoneyThink Mobile is a mobile application designed to supplement and enhance the face-to-face mentorship model that MoneyThink represents right now. There are a couple goals that we had when going into this. One was, let's extend the learning opportunity beyond the classroom, beyond the face-to-face experience, so that students can actually carry it with them in their pocket outside of the classroom. Secondly, we wanted a way to really collect more robust data about whether our curriculum and our program is really incentivizing students to change their spending behaviors, their saving behaviors. So this is a tool that's both going to extend what we're doing in the classroom and also enable us to really track whether we're making a change.
I believe the MoneyThink model of having college mentors work with our students is extremely important because it gives them somebody that's relatable in age and someone that they can look to. And I think it's important for students to understand some of the financial obligations and experiences that they will have, you know, once they leave high school.
Just like you manage your time, you really got to manage your money, because in school they really teach you how to make money, but nobody really teach you how to manage it. MoneyThink mentors could be role models for high school students, because that's where the high school students are going to end up in a few years. It's always great to see what you can be, or something even better.
There's a definite effect that society and the media has on the way we use money and the way we spend money. And, you know, programs like this, especially financial literacy, would go a long way in ensuring that all communities are healthy and that they can make the best financial decisions.
In high school, service was something I just did because it was like a box I had to check. It wasn't until I got into college that I realized how integral it is to just being a person and having like a well-developed worldview.
It just kind of like makes your week to know that you can build this relationship with someone who needs you there as a mentor and as an instructor. I would encourage anybody who's kind of interested in the movement at large to look into Money Think.
We are a generation empowering itself to reinvent the American dream. And we're not stopping until every kid in the U.S. receives a sound financial education before graduating high school.
Thank you. You know, it's crazy, as I was watching the video, it struck me, like it struck me many days and many weeks recently, that the young man Ryan Greenlaw in the video, who was a program graduate at the time that we filmed him, recently graduated from Swarthmore College, where he was on a scholarship, and his mentor in the Money Think program was our board chairman and co-founder 6 years ago, on the south side of Chicago, and now actually Ryan is our program lead for all of our Los Angeles programs, and we've actually hired him as our ninth staff member. So it's remarkable to achieve that stage in an organization's life cycle where the students that you started off with, that first cohort, actually are hireable back into the organization. So it's selfish, I guess, as an organization, because we're getting top talent. It's an honor to receive this award tonight alongside Eric and Rose. I'm so grateful to join this outstanding community of dragon tamers. Harmony has been on my mind a lot in the last year. I practice the martial art of Aikido, an art focused on harmonious action. And so it's interesting because Peace First and the work that you guys do is really close to my heart for reasons that are totally separate from the work that you guys just saw. But I practice this martial art of Aikido, and it's really focused on harmonious action. And my sensei and sort of longtime mentor for over half a decade passed away this March. And this loss made me consider which of the values he taught me that I really want to carry forward as sort of a core part of my being and my soul. And it, you know, at the top of this list of values was harmony. And what was crazy to me was that this deeply saddening passing happened 2 weeks after the most deeply joyful experience of my life, which was the birth of my son, Maximilian. And these cosmic tides shifting so quickly and suddenly gave me pause and made me consider even more seriously how I want to live out this value of harmony, because it's not just me anymore. So the timing here of this award is pretty magical for me on a deeply personal level, and I'm grateful for the chance Elfenworks and all of you and this community are giving me to reflect on this. It's reminded me that the work we do at Money Think is inherently a practice of harmony, one that inspires hope in our students, volunteers, and community of supporters. So in reconciling the deep sadness and the deep joy this past year, I've developed a new appreciation for an idea that I'd like to share with you that's long inspired me around social entrepreneurship and has informed a lot of big life choices that I've made so far on this path. And this idea also has a lot to do with social entrepreneurship's relationship to harmony. F. Scott Fitzgerald has an awesome quote, which is that the test of a first-rate intelligence is the ability to hold two opposed ideas in the mind at the same time and still retain the ability to function. Social entrepreneurship is kind of the ultimate test of this, right? You have to muster the empathy to feel sorrow and suffering and tragedy that this world holds. And at the same time, you have to muster the faith and optimism and belief to believe that people are good and that progress is possible. You have to have the humility to listen and shrink and lose yourself while maintaining at the same time the audacity to stand up and speak up and believe that you can define reality for you and others. For a great many, a small few, or even just one single life. And you have to have an urgency, right? A sense of outrage and impatience for change, while at the same time holding a restraint, an ability to patiently plod along toward a vision for a future that may take decades to truly and sustainably become an institutional part of society's moral and cultural fabric. I can't say that I have what Fitzgerald would call a first-rate intelligence, but I've had the chance to learn from many who have. And they've helped me and the team at MoneyThink to move forward day by day. I'm thrilled to join the Elfenworks community and to continue learning and growing together. I'm being asked to stop. Can I have 1 minute? I'm sorry, Rose, because I know we talked about this. You know, last night, Paul, a previous year's recipient, asked the whole dinner table, what's the essence of your program that you can't afford to lose as you grow? And everybody sort of, we'd been having this conversation about technology and social change, and everybody ended up at this answer, human connection. That technology, no matter how advanced it gets, well, I don't know, who knows what AI can do, but for now, technology is not a replacement. You know, we talked about Money Think Mobile, and Rose's organization does incredible stuff with technology, but it's not a replacement for human connection. It's an enhancement, and it's an enabler. And one of the encounters and questions we've had with technology at Money Think is around impact measurement. And we've gotten a lot of pressure from funders and from newspapers and online blogs to really go quant on impact measurement, measure numbers until you're sick. And so we've done that, and it's actually kind of cool because I'm from UChicago and I'm an economics nerd. But what's powerful is that, like, that conversation can go down a really, really distracting pathway if you lose sight of that core importance of human connection and harmony. And the one very short story that I always think back to is, in 2013, we were beginning to partner with IDEO, a group that actually a couple folks, Ian and Ginny, in the audience have come to support. They're at IDEO, and we were starting to work with IDEO to build a mobile application to help our students make better financial decisions and help us track them. And that summer, at our Summer Leadership Institute, where we gathered volunteer leaders from all across the country, it was the final day, and we'd done a bunch of workshops and sessions about impact measurement this, impact measurement that, and this really smart guy, who's now a top data scientist at a growing firm, he stands up, he's one of our top volunteers, and he says, you know what, with all this talk of impact measurement, I don't even know if my 3 years in the classroom have even made a difference. And, you know, we were like, in the reflection session, people were crying because they felt like they'd made a difference, and he's standing up and saying, I don't even know if I've made a difference. And, you know, this is a data guy. He's looking at the numbers. He can't tell at the time. And he didn't know that in the audience was a student that 3 years ago had been part of his mentoring session for the course of a year. And that student then stood up and said, Vrushank, that's the name of the mentor, he said, Vrushank, and he starts to tear up, and he says, you don't know the impact that you had on me because I never told you. And Vrushank is sort of speechless, and he's like, what do you mean? And also, I didn't even know you were here in the room. And Jeremiah, the student, says, right before the Money Think class started that year, my house was foreclosed, We didn't know where we were going to be. We didn't know where our income was going to come from. I didn't even know if I could go to college. And then you came in and started giving me information about money, just information. And you were there and you cared about us because I knew you weren't getting paid to come. And Vrushank was just stunned. And then they're both crying, and then everybody in the room is crying. And I always think back to it because with all of the talk of technology and where everything's going, and in light of this whole conversation of harmony and human connection, it's just like you never know what the impact is that you'll have, no matter how much you measure it, no matter how many surveys you put out, no matter how advanced the technology is. That true impact happens on such a deeper level. And you might not ever find out, and that's the point. Sorry for going over, but I just wanted to share that story and share how grateful I am to be a part of this community.
That was an amazing story. You gotta tell people what they do for you, you know, in light of the tragedies that happened today and your tragedy that happened just this week. If somebody touches their life and you got a chance to tell them, do it as soon as you can. Our final recipient, they saved the most beautiful for last, is Elijah Kelly. He is a handsome young from. Our final recipient of the evening is Miss Rose Broom from the Hand Up Foundation. She's the daughter of AT&T systems engineer who grew up in Silicon Valley. Rose is a native of San Francisco's startup culture. I think you need to become friends with her. Go down to Palo Alto and make some things happen. The genius of Hand Up lies in its simplicity. Rose and her co-founders, Sammy Rayner and Zach Witte, have fashioned a well-designed technology solution to a long-standing concern: how effectively to assist our homeless neighbors, brothers, and sisters without handing them actual cash and change on the street. They have built a mobile-friendly website that allows people to donate directly to the people that are in need. The crowdfunding site posts stories of our neighbors living on the margins. Those portraits include descriptions, the specific resources that would provide each Hand Up member with the ability to take those first crucial steps out of their homelessness. Donors visit the site to contribute to a Hand Up member's goals after reading through stories and selecting the one that speaks to them directly. Donors can also elect to contribute to the National Fund. Hand Up then allocates the funds from the National Fund to those it assesses that are most in need. Potential new members sign up with Hand Up through a number of well-respected partner social services agencies. A caseworker makes an assessment of a member's needs and encourages them in the crafting of their online story. Once funded, members work with their caseworker to fulfill that need. 100% of all donations, which doesn't happen a lot, which we all know, are funneled directly to that member, and that's beautiful. No skimming, no hiding, no pocketing. Just helping. Most donors learned of Hand Up through press efforts and word of mouth. But Hand Up members also have cards that can distribute on the streets that direct the people to their website. The newest option is a gift card that donors can present their home. You guys are like Hallmark. You guys got gift cards and everything. This is amazing. The gift cards can be redeemed, and all the member has to do is go to the organization, show up, give it in. Hand Up has already met more than 3,165 needs for 1,125 homeless neighbors. 3,000 donors have raised $1 million through this site. That's amazing. Members have had help getting houses, dentures, wheelchair repairs, birth certificates, or like Rodney, who we'll meet in a moment in the video, laptops that give them the freedom to look for their jobs. I want to stop for 2 seconds and just, my mother turned my childhood home and our family home into a personal care facility for the elderly, and took people off the street from homes and different hospices and things that weren't getting the care that they needed. So this is really resonating with me. And man, you guys are all superheroes. Like seriously, like, you know, being, and I'm sorry I'm stopping in the middle of it all, but being in Los Angeles and experiencing so much of people caring for themselves and only looking out for themselves. Every day is a constant reminder that the love that we have for each other is dwindling if we don't take care of that love, if we don't take care of that, those people. And when I look at you guys, I'm in awe. You know, I'm really, really in awe. Seriously. Back to it. So these pilot programs are underway in a limited number of other cities. Rose was reluctant to scale too quickly. Long-term, they are exploring systems that give the disenfranchised agencies the ability to help themselves and others. One option is becoming the platform that distributes federal funding to people facing inequality. Let's take a look at Rodney and Rose as they share their story in this final amazing video. Take a look.
I became paralyzed in a motorbike accident as a young adult. Through that journey of obtaining a new body, I found sports. I was dancing for an internationally renowned dance troupe here in the Bay Area. And last year, I was laid off from the dance company and I ended up homeless. Recently, I've found myself in a really beautiful place, and 90% of that is the reason is because of Hand Up. They gave me this huge opportunity to get back up on my wheels, I should say.
I was walking down the street on a particularly cold night in San Francisco, and I saw a woman sleeping on the sidewalk. And, you know, sadly, this has become such a common occurrence. We pass by homeless people on the streets every day. But that night, I think because it was so cold out, I really was struck by it. And I, you know, made a commitment to myself to do one thing to help. And that one thing became Hand Up. You know, oftentimes people are in the streets asking for help. And right now, a lot of people don't know how to respond to that. And it creates this feeling of pain where somebody's asking for help and you don't know what to do. You don't know if what you want to do is going to help them or hurt them. And this is a way to connect to people in that moment and, you know, not only help the donor have a way to give something positive, but also to have homeless people who are in the streets feel seen and feel like they can receive help from their community.
This is the great thing about Hand Up. You get this opportunity to reach out to friends, to do a short video and get a profile. It's very professional to be able to look at this website, boom, okay, I believe. And then I accumulated funds to get a laptop within a couple of weeks so that I could find employment and dance. They not only supported me financially, but a lot of them supported me emotionally as well.
Part of the impact that's really powerful for me is being able to see our members feel hope again, and hearing from them that they feel seen, that they feel like they're not invisible. The first feature request that our members had was wanting a way to express their gratitude. They said, who are these donors? Why are they helping us? And how can we thank them? And so we built in a way for them to express their thanks and for donors to be able to get those updates and to know what's going on and to use technology in that way to connect to communities that are very far apart and now can interact. That's a really big impact for me as well.
Because we all can dance, and it's just having that little lift up, or that hand up, I should say.
I want to ask all of you to imagine for just a minute what would happen if you lost your job and if you lost your home and you didn't have any friends or family that you could turn to for help. You would be homeless and you would feel so alone. And one of our hand-up members found herself in that situation, homeless for the first time when she was 7 months pregnant. And her name is Julianne. And Julianne sent an update to her donors on hand-up when she got a donation from them and some words of support, and I wanted to share her message with you. Julianne said, "Today doesn't feel as desperate or sad as days past. I often wonder how we are going to get everything taken care of to meet our goals. I'm usually left feeling stressed, alone, defeated. Instead, on September 1st, when I saw your donations, I took my daughter outside to enjoy the sunny day and to join her in smiling a lot. I was freed from worry, knowing we are lucky and not alone. You have guided me forward and given me hope. Thank you so much. We will find a way to achieving our goals." Notice that at the end of her update, Julianne thanks her donors not for their donations, but for the hope that they have given her. Because hope has the power to move us forward when life feels impossible. As you all saw in the video, I started Hand Up about 2 years ago after passing a woman on the street and wanting to do something to help. That night, as I crossed Market Street in San Francisco, I made a commitment to myself to do one thing. I was gonna just do one small thing. But that one thing turned into Hand Up, and I would love all of you to go to our site, handup.org, and share some hope with one of our Hand Up members. And you can read their stories just like Julianne's. In fact, you can read Julianne's story and send her some hope. So Hand Up wouldn't be what it is today without my co-founders, Sammy and Zach, and my teammates, Murphy and Katrina. Thank you. I'm so lucky to have so many people here today. And I wouldn't be who I am without my family, who supported me even when they weren't quite sure what this whole entrepreneurship thing was all about. And my friends like Jen, who's here tonight as well, who walk beside me through all of life's twists and turns. And I like to thank my boyfriend Nick, who gave me hope when the path forward with Hand Up was really hard and dark. Thank you. Because of all of you and so many others,
I mean, like, the first CEO who ever hired me is here today. One of my investors is here today. So many people have helped us get here. We were able to get HandUp up and running, and Julianne, she used HandUp to buy food and diapers for her baby, and now she's going to school studying accounting to become an accountant. She'd always been a bookkeeper, so she could support her family. I'd also like to thank the Elfenworks Foundation for the light and hope that they shine on our country, for recognizing HandUp's work and so many others' great work. Thank you. So there's something that's really freeing for me about being able to be up here tonight and speaking to you all. Usually when I'm speaking and talking about HandUp, I'm pitching investors. And so this is a chance where I can really be cheesy and let, you know, all of the goodness ooze out. the father of nonviolent communication, which I love, Marshall Rosenberg, he said that each of us has within us the power to fill the people around us with joy and hope if we choose to do so. And so, like the commitment that I made after passing that woman on the street 2 years ago, I'd like to invite everyone here to make a commitment to yourself to fill one person, either on HandUp or someone in your life or someone you pass on the street, to fill them with hope. And I think it's gonna fill you with hope and fill others with hope as well. So thank you.
No, no, stay, 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 stay. I want everybody to stand up and give these three amazing superheroes a round of applause. While you guys are clapping, Brad, David, and David, we thank you as well. And of course, none of this would be possible without our lovely, 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 lovely leader. Come on up here. The first time I met her, I told you guys that we were down in LA at the movie fest, and every student that came up to her, she gave so much love and so much support to individually. You didn't know I was watching you, but I was watching you. You made every single person feel like a superstar. Every actor feel like they were Al Pacino. Every director feel like they were Martin Scorsese. It was amazing. And I saw you do exactly what she just said, and you were filling those children with hope, each and every one of them, and they were all inflated in the best ways. And I appreciate you as an artist, as a young artist, what all of you do for, I don't like to say underprivileged. We got in this conversation in the car on the way here. I don't want to believe in underprivileged anymore. I think it's, the word that I want to use is undervalued. Because every human being on this planet has a value. And if our eyes are looking through filtered lenses where we aren't able to see that, we are perpetuating the negative inside of them. We're stifling them and we're censoring them. And I don't want to undervalue any humans anymore. And I think everyone is in here that is charged to make a change tonight. And I feel it in the room, it's strong, and I would want to be no other place. So thank you guys. Thank you for allowing me to be here.
Thank you.
We have one little film for you guys. We hope you'll enjoy it.
Like a star in the night, where this darkness shine your light. Hand in hand, take a stand for our time. Build a bridge.
I want to thank everyone for being with us one more time. And obviously, a lot of work went into tonight. I want to thank everyone from the foundation, and more specifically, I'd like to have Marion Sprague come up here. I think every year this thing gets better. Come on up, Marion. We couldn't possibly do this without all the tireless hours that Marion puts into this, and I just wanted to make sure that everybody, all of you who've come out here every flight, every hotel, that's all Marion. So again, thank you very, very much.
Quick story. I got my schedule mixed up. I called Miriam at 2 a.m. in the morning last night. She picked up the phone like it was 3 o'clock in the afternoon, chipper as ever, and she straightened everything out. She's amazing.
Thank you.
She works really
Please join us outside for some dessert and some coffee and some tea. Thank you again.
Tea.
Oh.
Can you just give it up for the team? Is the Elfenworks team cool? Every team member stand up. Is this team rock? Oh my God, this is my team. Go team.